Hello and welcome. My name is Tracy Flynn, Training and Communications Manager at SADA Systems. Today's session, we will cover your new Google Calendar. One of the first things you'll want to do is remember that Google is a browser-based product, and so your choice of browser is very important. During this presentation, I'll be showing you the Chrome browser. The Chrome browser will always give you the best experience. However, you'll be able to use your new Google Calendar in Chrome, Safari, Firefox, or Internet Explorer. Internet Explorer will be a little bit slower, and you may be missing a few features, but you should be fine. So again, in order, we recommend Chrome, Safari, Firefox, Internet Explorer. So one of the first things that we're going to do is we're going to go into our settings in the upper right-hand corner. This will allow us to customize and personalize our experience. So don't guess and don't memorize what any of the buttons do. You'll simply just hold your mouse over any of the icons and let the system tell you exactly what it does. So the gear in my upper right-hand corner tells me that those are my settings. I'll give that a single click, and then I'll click on Settings again. Remember, your settings are going to allow you to customize and personalize your experience. Doesn't ever hurt to make sure you're in the correct time zone so that all your meetings are showing up correctly. We're going to scroll down to the very bottom, and we're going to cover a few of the most important settings that are actually on automatically. So by default, you will notice that you have two settings which are on by default. One of them is called Show Events That You Have Declined. On by default, you can certainly turn it off if you like. What this means is when I get invited to a meeting and I have decided that I cannot attend, so I decline, it will still show on my calendar as kind of a visibility. So I've clearly declined it, it'll be grayed out, it'll have a strike through, and it will indicate that I've clearly declined it. But it will still be on my calendar, mainly for visibility. You can choose to turn that feature off, so you've declined your meeting, you certainly don't need to have it show on your calendar. So that's an important setting that you'll want to decide probably pretty early on if you want that off or on. Remember, it is on by default. The second setting that you'll want to decide about is automatically add invitations to my calendar. Also on by default. And what this will do is before you even accept, decline, or say maybe, this calendar event will show on your calendar kind of as a placeholder. I actually really like this one myself. I find it very useful, but remember, it is a personal choice. So show events that you have declined. Anything you've declined will still show on your calendar. It'll be grayed out, should be fairly obvious. It has the strike through that you've declined that meeting. Mostly you get invited to meetings, you can't attend, you still need to have that visibility. And then also on by default, automatically add invitations to my calendar. Before I even say yes, no, or maybe to that invitation, it will show on my calendar as a placeholder. Be sure to always click Save to save any settings. We're going to, at this time, create an event. There are, of course, many different ways to do anything with technology. My recommendation is always click the red Create button in your upper left-hand corner. After we do that, I'll show you a couple of other ways you can do it. But really, if you need to create an event, this is probably the best way. So I'm going to go ahead and click Create. I need to give my event a title. So I'm going to call this Department Meeting. I can click on the date and change the date. I'll make that for Monday the 23rd. If I click on the time, please remember that those half-hour increments are just suggestions. So if I need my meeting to start at 4:15, I could just backspace, type in 4:15. I don't even need the colon or the P or anything. I can tap or click over into the end time, and I can make my meeting end at, let's say, 5:35. So again, those half hour increments are just suggestions. You can type over them. If you need to have a repeating event, I can click Repeat. You should notice all of your appropriate repetition options. So maybe I want this to be a monthly meeting, and maybe I want that to be on the fourth Monday of the week of the month. I'm going to go ahead and cancel that. Now, here is an important part of your new Google Calendar. I can go ahead and invite John, As I start to type in John's name, if he's in my Google contacts, he will show up. Otherwise, you can go ahead and just type in that person's email address. I'm going to go ahead and add John. A very important piece of the Google Calendar as well is the Find a Time feature. So over on the left, it's kind of grayed out, might be pretty easy to miss. I can go ahead and click that Find a Time feature on the left, and it will show my calendar, UCB Trainer. It'll show my calendar here on the left, and it will also show John's availability here as well. So again, this will just show me any free busy time unless John has specifically given me permission to his calendar. And we'll talk about permissions in just a few moments. So I clicked on Find a Time. I actually need to move that up a little bit. I'm going to go ahead and move that up. And you can click and drag to change the date and time, or you can do so from the very top, whatever is your preference. Then I go back to Event Details. And just remember, if you were having a difficult time finding when both of you are available, both myself and John, I could just click on Suggested Times underneath Guests, and it will bring up the next time he and I are both available. So why not make the computer do all the work instead of me? So I think Tuesday at 12:30 looks good. I'll go ahead and just click on that, and then I've set my new time. So again, you can manually click on the Find a Time. If you're not easily able to find a time that works for both of you, you can certainly click on the Suggested Times as well. Everything in Google is about permission, so keep in mind that there is permission you can give your guest to this event. If you want them to be able to, let's say, suggest a time or move the date and time without having to, you know, send you an email and ask you to do it, you can allow them to modify the event. This feature is not on by default. You would need to specifically give this permission to this individual. The two permissions that are on by default are invite others and see the guest list. That means that if John was listed here as the guest, he would simply type in anybody else's name that he feels also needs to attend this meeting. He doesn't forward the meeting invitation. That invitation is just for him. He's looking at the guest list, and he can clearly see that another person needs to attend this event. So no need to go all the way to his inbox and forward the meeting. He can just type in their email address here under guests. If this is a private meeting, perhaps I don't want him to be able to invite others, I can simply uncheck that box. If I don't perhaps even want him to see the guest list, I can uncheck that feature as well. On the left, I can go ahead and add up to 5 reminders. That might be a bit much. They can be any combination of email or pop-up, and it can be any combination of minutes, hours, days, or weeks. So depending on your preference as to your reminders. Now, I did say we were going to talk about permission in just a few moments. So here, perhaps I'm sharing my calendar with my coworkers, which is a good idea, but I want this particular event to be private. Please keep in mind that it is possible for John to change this privacy to public. Then it is possible, while not likely or even probable, that this event could become public. Again, nothing is truly private if you're inviting anybody else. It's a possibility. It is not a probability. There's really no reason John would do that. But we always do want to make sure that you're aware of things that your guests can do. I go ahead and scroll up. When I click on Save in the upper left-hand corner, it will ask me if I want to send my invitations, which I do. It would be rude not to. So I'm going to go ahead and click Send. So now John anxiously awaits his invitation, and he can go ahead and accept, decline, or say maybe. Now, I did say there were a couple of other ways that I can create event. I could single left click and create my event, kind of a quick way. I can also double left click, and that will open up the complete edit capability. And then for you clickers and draggers, you can also click and drag, and you would perhaps also need to edit that event as well. So again, many different ways to do the exact same thing. I find that most people just click create in the upper left-hand corner, and you're fine. Now, we did say everything was about permission and your Google Calendar. So the UCB team is working very hard to bring over your existing Oracle Calendar permissions. But perhaps you are an individual listening to this presentation and you did not have an Oracle Calendar. You could go ahead and click the drop-down arrow next to your name. And you would simply click Share This Calendar. Or even perhaps you had an Oracle Calendar and now you want to give additional individuals access to your calendar. Please note at the very top, it's just reminding me that everybody at UCB can see my free busy time. And this is a good thing because then they won't overbook me. They'll click on the Find a Time and they'll see my free and busy time. Now, if I want to, again, I can go ahead and type in John's name. And I can decide to give him additional permission. So everybody at the university can see my free busy time. However, in this instance, John would be able to see my event details. So he and he alone, actually he and David in this case, I've shared with both of them, these two individuals would be able to see exactly my meeting titles, who I'm meeting with, etc. So perhaps we're colleagues and they need to have this information. I can always change or take away permission at any time. So again, I can change or take away permission at any time. I'm going to go ahead and cancel. You would, of course, save if you needed to. I can also click the drop-down arrow right next to my name, and I can click on notifications. Most of you are pretty aware of what your preferences are for your default meeting reminders. Remember, as we just saw, each individual meeting can have its own reminders, but perhaps by default I want a pop-up for 5 minutes before my meeting, and I want an email 15 minutes before my meetings. So these would be my default reminders. Each individual meeting can have its own, but this one, no matter what, if I didn't change them, would have a pop-up and an email. You can, of course, search your calendar. It is a Google product. You have your very robust search. You have your drop-down arrow at the end of that search that will actually allow you to do a more advanced search. So remember, you can search your calendar. Just type in your keywords as you would do at google.com. And you also have a more advanced search by clicking the drop-down arrow. We are going to take a look at someone else's calendar. So I'm going to type in John's name under Other Calendars. His name shows up in the autocomplete because I've emailed him before. John's calendar, he's allowed me to see his event details, so I can see that we are both in, it looks like, the same meetings. John's calendar is purple, and I know that because on my left, it is purple. I can click the drop-down arrow next to his name and make it red. My calendar is kind of a light blue, and so the color is always just for contrast. The color is always just for contrast. I've also typed in David's name, and I can see David's calendar if I like. And so let me scroll up just a little bit and click on David's name. And so David's calendar is going to be in green, and David has also allowed me to see his event details. So just remember, if you have permission to somebody's calendar, you can see their details. If not, you would only be able to see their free busy time. You would see those blocks of time where they are busy. I can click once on John's name to take away his calendar from my view, and I can also click on David's calendar to take them off my view. In my upper right-hand corner, I can change how I'm viewing my calendar. I can click on day and week and month. I have a custom view here of 2 weeks. And I also have an agenda view, which kind of gives me my day at a glance. Most people do prefer the week view. You can always change your default view in your settings. That concludes the Calendar Basics sessions. Please remember, it is a Google product, so you should be able to search your calendar very easily. Being a browser-based product, again, you do want to remember your choice of browser is important. We're recommending Chrome. But if need be, Firefox works very well. Safari works very well. The one browser that might not work as well, it'll still work, but not as well, would be Internet Explorer. Thank you so much for joining us today, and we hope you enjoy your new Google Calendar.